My name is Ryan. I'm with Rock Island Auction Company as one of the describers. And here today we have a number of items in our September sale that are of personal interest. Now, the majority of the items we have here are part of the Class 3 selection, machine guns, short-barreled rifles, combination weapons. First one we got here, if it wants to play, is the Valmet M62S. Now, this started life as an imported semi-automatic rifle, and like a lot of guns that came in, it was converted to fully automatic before the 1986 rule changes. It is a fully transferable machine gun capable of semi and full automatic fire. Now, historically speaking, this is one of the more popular variations of the AK family of weapons refined in Finland. Kind of a running theme with Finnish weapons. They often got their hands on Russian or Soviet hardware, made their own little adjustments to them. In this particular case, they made some refinements to the gas system. This entire section here can just slide right off once you've got the dust cover off, which in turn was reinforced to allow them to move the rear sight back, give them greater sight radius, as well as integrating flip-up high-visibility front sight. They didn't do anything too crazy with it. They just made some neat little adjustments to make it a little more effective as an infantry rifle. Next up on the table, we get the Armalite AR-18, originally designed by Armalite. This example was manufactured in California. Now, the AR-18 was kind of the younger brother to the AR-15, M16 family of weapons. They developed it after they parted with a lot of their patents on the M16, so they needed to go back and explore new ways of doing business. Now, they did a lot of things here which would later become very popular with automatic weapons and, you know, the black sporting rifles. Now, by rearranging the gas system from the impingement mode of the original to a gas piston system, they were able to get the buffer tube out of the buttstock here, so they were able to integrate folding buttstock, which is a feature that has become more and more popular on assault rifles. They also switched to very heavy stamped steel construction in lieu of aluminum, which allows them to make it on different equipment, with the mind being to make it cheaper, faster, more appealing to export buyers. Now, the piston system in particular, you can see it right through there, is of note because there's been a very large drive over the past couple of years to switch over to piston drive. There's a notion that it is more reliable, cleaner, exhaust less gas into the receiver. Now, whether or not it is better or worse is a topic we cannot touch without turning the internet into a river of flame, so we're not gonna. We're not gonna say it's better, we're not gonna say it's worse, we're gonna say it's there. Now, next one we got up here, Springfield M14 National Match Variation. Now, this weapon started life as a machine gun. It is registered, fully transferable as a machine gun, but it has been altered. Certain parts of the selector hardware have been removed. You can see externally, if you're familiar with that selector switch on the M14, it's just that solid block there. So this is, in function, a semi-automatic rifle. It was modified in this way to be used for, you know, target purposes in the national matches where one would use as close to a military issue rifle as they could. Now, as a matter of policy, we cannot guarantee that this weapon can be restored to fully automatic fire. What we can say is that it is a pretty rare beast in that very few M14s that were original military production got registered. Most of them either stayed in Army inventory until they were effectively destroyed in use, or they were seconded to allies or NATO partners, or just thrown in a shredder, which is a pretty sad way to end a military career. But that's how it goes sometimes. You know, opportunities to get an original M14 can be scarce, so regardless of its fire mode, it is definitely an item of interest. Now, moving around to the next table, the previous ones we saw here were coming from a multitude of sources. We get consignments throughout the country from just about everywhere. These four items in particular come from a single source. Now, the name here, some of you will recognize it right out. These items came from the family of Mitchell WerBell III. Now, for those of you who are not familiar with that name, I recommend looking him up on Google. He has a very interesting life story, very intricate, very complicated. In terms of his accomplishments as in the arms field, he was one of the minds behind the psionic suppressor that was matched up with the M10 submachine gun, possibly one of the most iconic combinations of SMG and silencer. All four items here come from his collection. Now, a number of his items were of the Class 3 persuasion. This one here was an AR-15 Model 639 select fire rifle. Came from the factory with full function, selector switch, safe, semi, and full. Now, this particular example has had some work done on it. Now, anybody who's familiar with his history will recognize that unless Mitchell WerBell III owned a DeLorean, there is no way he could have an A4 upper on his AR-15 before his unfortunate death. This one has had it swapped out. We've got that A4 upper on there. We still have that older pattern AR-15 lower, multi-position buttstock, the older pattern two-stop as opposed to the more modern six-position there, just to bring down the length. Moving over a little bit, we get to the M6 survival rifle. This one is Ithaca production. Now, it's a pretty simple weapon, solid steel construction, two barrels seated in a solid block there, rifled upper, shotgun lower, little flip up container for spare ammo. Idea being that you could just load around ammo in there, stick it in a drop bag, shove it behind a seat somewhere on your aircraft and have it there in case you need it. Now, you don't see too many of these making it out into the field. Now, much like with the M14, there was not too much of a drive to get these things cleared out of surplus into commercial channels. A lot of them were just kept in use until they ran out their service life. So it's always nice to see one of these original out in the field. Now, this one here is not a Class 3 item, but it is still very nice. It is an Astra Cub semi-automatic pistol, nice little 22 caliber pocket gun. This one has been very heavily decorated across pretty much the entire surface. We got, you know, your scroll work virtually everywhere. Got nice monogram pattern on the back. Astra went ahead and did their logo right on the front there, very nice detail. And then on the grip panels, we have a set of nice Eagle logos there, the American style on the left, Spanish style on the right. So very, very heavy coverage. You typically don't see a lot of pocket guns that are looking this fancy. I mean, by nature of their intention, they tend to be kept close on the body, often hauled in and out of clothing. They tend to suffer a lot of wear. This one was very well taken care of. Seeing a little bit of loss on the edges, but nothing really large. It's very good shape. Now, we saved this one for last because it has a lot going on in terms of its mechanics and its history. Now, we mentioned earlier that WerBell was one of the minds behind the psionic silencer M10 submachine gun combo. Now, in the course of selling and marketing that item, he spent a lot of time going abroad, including places like Vietnam, to convince people making purchasing decisions that his weapon combination was the right one. According to the story that came from the family, one day, unspecified date, when he was over in Vietnam trying to sell his gun, somebody approached him with this pistol and tried to kill him. This pistol is a Chinese Type 64 dual mode suppressed silence pistol. That person got shot in the head with a 22 caliber pistol of unidentified make. And as a side effect of being dead, he wasn't able to tell anyone who sent him to take out WerBell. So unfortunately, that part of the history is lost. Fortunately, WerBell's family was able to tell us his side of the story, which was that this guy approached him and he shot him in the forehead, which is a short story, but kind of a neat one. Now, in terms of function, shoots a proprietary small bore round. Basic function of this item comes in two forms. Now, you can see a little selector switch on top here. Moves to the left, moves to the right. It's pretty simple. Now, when it's moved over like so, see if we can show you this breech face here. There is an element in there that retracts into this. This really is more like a bolt carrier than it is a true slide. Now, when it's locked back like that, This operates as a traditional straight blowback semi-automatic pistol, not too different from, you know, your conventional Makarov, aside from the redesign of the guts. Now, we flip that switch over like that. That's all it takes. We can pop this back. There's an element that is now projecting from that slide. When we let that down, hopefully you'll be able to see this when we close it, that drops down and engages like a rotating bolt against part of the frame. Now, when that is engaged like that, that serves as an integral slide lock. So when you fire this with that in that position, the bolt stays in place, the carrier doesn't move, all the gases from firing go forward into this assembly here. Now, your actual barrel is terminating right about here and is very thin. It's about finger width. So all the extra area around here and going down below is expansion space for all the gases that are being created by firing. And then the rifle bullet itself just kind of freebores through there and passes through the front. And because the breech doesn't open up, you don't need to worry about mechanical noise. You don't need to worry about, you know, the sound of it cycling. And it is more efficient in directing all the gases forward here, because it's an issue with silenced weapons sometimes. There's an increase in back pressure because gas is not releasing as it would conventionally. And with a blowback operated pistol, that can result in more gas leaving the back than in normal operation. Now, in terms of how this weapon would be used, there's a lot of parallels between the Type 64 and the American weapons at the time, most famously the 9mm Hush Puppy. Now, in terms of what it takes to build and maintain it, since it's proprietary ammo, you got to worry about that. Parts are proprietary, so you don't have as much overlap. That's an advantage the Hush Puppy has. They use a lot of commercially available guns. But advantage over this is that since this is all redesigned, they're able to put more of the silencer space down below, so they're able to preserve that, you know, basic sight profile up top. They don't need to have like the elevated sights up top like you'd see on the American 9mm. Also, the American designs, since they kind of emphasized using commercial guns that have been redesigned, had a slide lock mechanism you typically had to manually manipulate. Whereas this one, you don't need to manipulate anything other than this slide up top. You just grab it like that, single shot, every time. Less to fumble with, less to mess around with, less chance of throwing a switch at the wrong time and messing something up. Now, the holster that comes with it will be familiar to anyone who's seen a lot of the Chinese broom handle pistols. Now, it was designed with a clip back here that could just rapidly come off, and they've designed it so that with the exception of the safety that's concealed on the backside here, you can pretty much access every part of the gun. The muzzle is uncovered. The ejection path for the casing is uncovered. You can access the trigger just fine and the magazine up back. So in a pinch, if this gun got stuck in its holster, you could shoot it without unholstering. You just yank the whole thing off your belt, bang. But hopefully it doesn't come to that, because if it comes to that, you've probably gotten too much moisture on your gun. Now, these are just a few of the items we have coming up in the September sale. The WerBell collection has a large number of items, both Class 3 and conventional, and I believe you will be seeing that across multiple sales. The Class 3 selection, as a general sense, very broad, got a pretty wide selection from submachine guns all the way up to tripod-mounted, water-cooled, heavy guns. There is something there for pretty much everybody who wants a Class 3 weapon.